Good morning and welcome to the Cellar Church. We're so happy that you've joined with us this morning. Let's prepare our hearts and our minds and let's worship our Jesus, our Saviour. So let's sing together. Be bold and strong. Do not fear or dread them, because the Lord God goes with you. He will not fail you or forsake you.
Feet may fail, and there. It's so good to have you come and join us in worship at the Cellar Church online. And we are so pleased and grateful to our musicians and our singers for leading us and helping us in our time of worship. Whether this is your first time with us or you've been with us for months, we are pleased that you are here. Now, as a nation, we are currently in a position of such uncertainty. There's nervousness in so many lives as the impact of the possibility of a second wave of pandemic and lockdowns around the country. We come to a point where we can get very, very nervous, even as Christians. But you know, God's Word, the Bible, helps us with that. In the book of Ecclesiastes, we are reminded in that book that there is a time and a season for everything under heaven. And that even applies to these days. We come before a God, and we've already sung and worshipped a God who knows the beginning from the end. And we can trace his movements, his actions through history, human history. And that's a challenge for us in our days and the seasons of our own lives. Now, as we come this morning and lift our hearts in prayer and in praise and in worship, we recognize there is no other God than the God of the Bible. Let me read to you some words from 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 13. Therefore, with your minds ready for action, be serious and set your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ.
Plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Jeremiah 29, verse 11.
Thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. blessings are mine with 10,000 beside.
Dear Lord, we do thank you for the privilege of prayer and come now to intercede before you for all those who are caught up in the COVID-19 pandemic, where the situation seems to be getting worse and worse. Lives have been lost, homes torn apart, jobs and businesses destroyed, and there seems just no end in sight. So Lord, in your great mercy, will you please forgive us as a nation for our collective failure to obey rules which the government has made about social distancing and all the other stuff. Will you break through it with your mighty power, cause the death toll to drop, new cases to reduce drastically, and cause an effective vaccine to be brought in quickly? Please will you give your wisdom to those researching for a vaccine, to politicians and their medical and scientific advisers on how to manage the crisis, and give care staff the skill they need in caring for those who are ill. We in the UK are less badly affected than so many third world countries already struggling with the effects of war and poverty, drought and crop failures, and now COVID-19 has made bad matters even worse in those cases. Please will you have pity on Christians who are small minorities in countries who oppress them and either deny them food altogether or other relief, and make them last in the queue. Lord, thank you for Christian agencies like Tear Fund, Open Doors and others, who often at great risk to themselves are seeking to help your people. But please will you galvanise your church in this country and elsewhere to pray earnestly and constantly over these issues. We are so grateful for your gracious love to us, that you're a good and kind and merciful God, whose steadfast, everlasting love never fails. In your holy and precious name, amen.
First thing to know is TCC Connect Group every Tuesday evening on Zoom. Time to pray, share and see each other. For more details, contact us on the TCC Facebook page.
Second thing to know, please remember to call others to check if they are well and if they need anything, especially keep in contact with our older friends.
The third thing to know, please remember in your prayers the global missions we support as a church.
The Spanish Gospel Mission.
Our neighbour Zimbabwe.
And the Messenger Across Asia.
So it's that time in our service to call the kids, call them from wherever they are in the house, get them to sit down and let's look at God's word together. Kids, I wonder if you've ever done something wrong. Whether you've messed up big time. You know when you've been disobedient or you've made a mistake. Here's some news. Not any one of us You little guys, or to those of us who are bigger, are perfect. We all do things wrong. The ancient people of Israel, God's special people, were always doing wrong things. They always went against what God had to say. They were very, very disobedient. But even when they got things wrong, do you know? God still loved them, just like us. And God always forgave them. Let's hear God's story.
God's story, the Ten Commandments and the Golden Calf. So part of God's story is about one of the many times God forgave his family, and it begins like this. Remember how God chose Moses to lead his family out of slavery in Egypt? God wanted his family to be free and happy in the wonderful home he promised them, called Canaan. All they had to do was follow God home through the wilderness. The problem was, they kept disobeying God instead of following him. They kept trying to do things their own way. So one day, while the Israelites were on their way to Canaan, God told them what he expected from his family. Basically, how to treat each other, how to love God, and how to be part of his team. And with God on their side, the Israelites wouldn't need to worry about anything. This sounded pretty good, so Moses went up a mountain called Sinai to talk to God about it. There, God gave them 10 rules to live by, called 10 Commandments. Turns out, God had a lot more to say. He and Moses talked for 40 more days and nights. During that time, God's family got tired of waiting for their leader, so they asked Moses' brother Aaron to make them new gods to worship. But the very first commandment God had given Moses was, "You must not have any other god but me." Aaron and the people had just heard that. But Aaron wanted to make the people happy more than he wanted to make God happy. So he collected all their gold, melted it down, and turned it into a calf. That's a baby cow. They worshipped the calf and said, "These are the gods who brought us out of the land of Egypt." Well, God knew what was happening, and he told Moses to get back to the people. When Moses saw what they were doing, he was so angry that he smashed the Ten Commandments God had written for him on the ground. Then he burned the calf, ground it to powder, threw it into the water, and made the people drink it, because it's a big deal when we choose to disobey God. Finally, Moses turned to Aaron and asked what happened. Aaron said, "I threw their gold jewelry into the fire, and out came this calf." Even though the people disobeyed God, and even though they weren't all sorry for what they did, Moses begged God to forgive them. He reminded God how much he loved Israel. They were his special family. Of course, God did love them, and because Moses asked him to, God forgave them. See, God knew it would be impossible for his family to be perfect. That's why he sent them Moses, a leader who could show them how to follow God and remind God how much he loved his family. And for many years, God would continue to choose leaders, sometimes called prophets or judges or kings, who would tell God's family when they messed up and ask God to forgive them, because God loves to forgive. And that's a story of forgiveness. But that's not all there is. Later, God sent his perfect son, Jesus, to rescue the whole world. He did that by taking the punishment that we deserve. Now, everyone in the whole world can become part of God's family. And one day, we'll live with him in a perfect home, joyful and free, just like God planned all along. And that's a part of God's story.
Isn't that amazing that God forgave his people despite the wrong things that they did and drew them back? And today, that is exactly the same. That in Jesus, when we have a friendship with Jesus, we can ask him to forgive all the wrong things we've ever done, that we can say sorry for our sin, and he will wipe the slate clean. Whatever age we are, whoever we are, that is the promise of God's word, the Bible. Do you know, as we continue in our journey and our sermon series of the life of Jesus, and as we come to probably one of the most influential of all the Roman officials of the day, the greatest governor probably who ever existed, we meet Pontius Pilate. But when we come to this reading from John chapter 18, Pontius Pilate meets face to face with Jesus, and it changes everything. Let's listen as Chris and Helen read for us from God's word this morning.
John chapter 18, verses 28 to 40. Jesus before Pilate. Then the Jews led Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, the Jews did not enter the palace. They wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," the Jews objected. This happened so that the words Jesus had spoken, indicating the kind of death he was going to die, would be fulfilled.
Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea, Jesus asked, "or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "Your own people and chief priests handed you over to me. What is it you've done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then?" Pilate said. Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" retorted Pilate. With this, he went out again to the Jews gathered there and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him. But it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in an uprising.
The story is told of President Abraham Lincoln. Historians tell us that whilst on the campaign trail, he was approached by a man who drew a gun and pointed it straight at his face. Lincoln very calmly said, "Sir, what appears to be the matter?" The man replied, "I took an oath many years ago that if I ever met a man who was more ugly than me, I would shoot him on the spot." Lincoln paused for a while and then with a smile replied, "Well, shoot me then. Because if I am half as ugly as you are, sir, I'm not sure I want to live." Awkward, awkward conversations. You ever had one of those? You know those times where you're in a conversation and suddenly, I don't know, the words dry up or your mind goes blank or there's some subject you really don't want to discuss. You get to that point where you just wish that the earth would open up and you'd disappear or you'd rather be anywhere else. Or as a friend of mine used to say, if he believed in a rapture, now would be a really good piece of timing. This morning, we're going to continue our journey in the life of Jesus through the eyes of John, that closest of disciples. The cross is approaching, and the fulfillment of God's perfect plan of salvation is in its last week, in its last days. Last time we considered how Jesus, having been arrested, having been dragged off by that lynch mob, is now taken to the temple. And how in the courtyard, Peter, who'd followed that faithful follower, had been put into panic mode and had denied under pressure. He'd crumbled under pressure and denied and lied and even swore that he never knew this Jesus. Just to save his own neck, denying knowing him, following him, and then the rooster crowed. Just as Jesus promised, Peter sees Jesus looking at him and he is brought to his knees. And yet those eyes of Jesus, despite all that was going on around him for Peter, was compassion. Now events have moved on and it's now emerging that we have that scene. No conclusion or little conclusion has come from the religious court of Caiaphas, the high priest. we read Jesus now is removed from there and he's taken to the Roman governor's palace, known as the Praetorium. And what follows is, without doubt, the most awkward of all the conversations anywhere in the New Testament. A conversation between Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and Pontius Pilate, the governor of the Roman province of Judea, the representative, the illustration of the power of Rome and its emperor Tiberius. A conversation like no other that Pilate or anyone else had ever encountered. Verse 28 tells us that by this time, it is early morning. It's been a long night. And in order to avoid being ceremonially unclean, the Jewish authorities, the Jewish leaders, did not enter the governor's palace because they wanted to be ready for Passover and they didn't want to be found to be impure by entertaining or going into the home of a Gentile. How ironic is that? How ironic that Jesus once described these very same men as whitewashed tombs. It's a good picture, isn't it? Looking at the outside so good, but spiritually inside dead, full of decay. It's an apt picture. These religious people wanting to be super spiritual, wanting to stick to the religious rules that they'd put in place. They didn't want to miss out on attending a religious ceremony, supposedly to worship God. So they refused to be dirtied by association with a pagan Roman governor, whilst all the time being hell-bent on murdering God's Son. Pure hypocrisy. And that's one of the greatest challenges for today. That when we are representing Jesus, when we say we are Christian, we need to hear the warning of Matthew chapter 7 and 21. It says this, "For not everyone who says, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven." Is that a challenge for some of you this morning? Is that a challenge? You're watching a service online. Great. You believe there's a God. Great. You even believe that maybe someone called Jesus Christ once existed, but you are a Christian because of some religious ceremony that you went through as a child. You say you are Christian. You're a good person. Well, all of those is great, except you do not have a personal relationship with Christ. Your talk. You've got a great facade, but your heart is far away from the things of God. Someone once said this, "Hypocrites are greatly offended by the truth." The Jewish authorities certainly were offended by the truth of Jesus, the living truth. They wanted him dead, but they were unwilling to kill him. They were unwilling to get blood on their own hands. They didn't want to do that because they didn't want to lose favor with the general population. There were many ordinary people who believed in Jesus. Take the 5,000 who were fed. The religious leaders didn't want to put themselves in an awkward position. They didn't want blood on their hands. They wanted Rome to do it. They wanted the unpopular occupiers to take the blame. They wanted Rome to take the blame. And these religious leaders, well, they managed to play Pontius Pilate like a fiddle. They managed to maneuver him to get to their goal. Before we learn the lessons of that awkward conversation, and there are a number of lessons to learn, let's discover a little bit more about the Roman governor himself. Now, we talk about Pontius Pilate a lot, but I wonder how much you actually know about him as a character. What history actually tells us. Well, in some areas we know very little. In others, we know a lot. Almost nothing is known about Pontius Pilate's birthplace or his background. But thanks to historians and their research, what we do know is this. Pontius Pilate was the fifth person to be appointed as governor of Judea. He was appointed by Caesar Tiberius in the year 26 AD. He held the position for around about 10 years, and up until Pilate was appointed as governor, the governor only held military power. He only had a position that held military power over the region, while one of his superiors would look after the civil issues and would have the civil power. However, due to a lot of infighting in Rome, they'd neglected to appoint anyone to look after civil matters. And so, for the very first time, a governor in Judea, Pontius Pilate, is given responsibility for both military and civil matters. He has huge power combining the two. And during that time, he is faced with the conversation with Jesus and having to make a decision on that particular issue. Like Caesar Tiberius, Pontius Pilate did not have fond feelings for the Jews. In fact, during his first years of rule, he demonstrated a complete contempt for the Jewish religion, for their morals, for their culture, and for their customs and their teaching. On one occasion, he attempted to bring the Roman flags, the Roman standards, into Jerusalem, but he brought them in by night. These standards had pagan images all over them, and the Jews considered it a way of spiritually polluting their holy city. Pilate refused to remove them, and so the Jews began to demonstrate. Pilate was in the process and was about to issue a death warrant for the leader of those particular protests, but he came under pressure, and soon he relented and he took the standards out of the city again. But soon after that, historians tell us that in revenge, Pilate stole money from the Jewish temple to pay for an aqueduct in the Bethlehem area, from Bethlehem all the way to Jerusalem. A large crowd again appeared in protest outside of Caesarea, his castle, if you like, his fortified house. So in response, Pontius Pilate sends his soldiers undercover, dressed as Jews, to mingle with the crowds. And then at a single word, they drew clubs and swords from under their clothes, and they beat the other protesters. Many of them were beaten to death on that occasion. Luke chapter 13, 1 makes an amazing statement. It talks about the blood of those that Pontius Pilate, the Gentiles that Pontius Pilate had murdered, that he mixed that with the blood of Jewish worship. It's not only a picture of desecration of Jewish ceremony, but of the sheer brutality of this man, Pontius Pilate. Pilate had such a horrible, horrible record. Then how amazing is it that when Jesus Christ is brought to him, it appears at least that when these Jews have this desire to kill him, he has a desire for justice. There's almost a moral compass there that seems to have turned round. This man before Pilate believed that Jesus was innocent and undeserving of the death penalty. Several times we know that he attempted to save Jesus from that penalty. So there's the history lesson. But we know that Pilate was brutal, that without morals, he had a track record of willingness to defy the Jewish authorities in the past. Why was it that he was unwilling on this occasion to defy them on that day? Well, did they have something over him? Well, the truth is, yes, they did. In fact, at that point, Pontius Pilate was incredibly nervous of the Jewish authorities. You see, it would appear that 6 months after trying to bring the flags in at night to the city, and then having to remove them again, a second attempt was made, this time using shields. he wanted to decorate the city of Jerusalem with golden shields. Now, unlike the first time, these shields didn't have kind of pagan symbols on them, but what they did have was references to Caesar worship, to idolatry. And so again, the Jewish authorities were offended. But this time, they took their offence directly to Tiberius, to Caesar himself. In response, Tiberius, wanting to maintain a kind of a submission of the Jewish and Roman authorities there, sends a blistering letter to Pontius Pilate, warning him that those shields had to be removed and that he was under observation. Rome and Caesar were looking at Pontius Pilate very carefully in everything he did. The message was clear. If he was going to survive as governor, in fact, if he was going to survive as in life generally, being monitored by Caesar, then his position was frail. It was fragile. And the Jewish leaders knew it. And because of that, they successfully threatened into submission their will on Pontius Pilate. As I say, so much for the history lesson. But here we are. Pilate, as he stands in conversation with Jesus, asks three questions. Three questions. One was a question of the crowd. The second question was of Jesus himself. And the third question was a question that challenged Pontius Pilate and his own life. So let's look at those together. But let's pray first and ask God to apply them. Heavenly Father, we ask that you will apply your word to us now, that you will lead and guide us, that as we hear the questions that are asked and the response that is given, will you direct our minds and our thoughts that we may follow you and that you will transform us. Help us now. In Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. The first question that Pilate asks is found there in verse 29 of John chapter 18. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" Pilate asked the Jewish leaders and the assembled group there, what were the formal charges for the prisoner? Now, John doesn't tell us here, but it's clear in the narrative that it begins to unfold, Jesus is being accused of being a king, a subversive. Dr. Luke records the charges that are brought against him in Luke chapter 23. In Luke chapter 23, we read this. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be the Messiah, a king. He stirs up people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here." Though the Jewish leaders have condemned Jesus really on a theological basis, they really, as we know from the earlier court hearing, have accused him of blasphemy, saying that he is God. When they come to Pilate now, the charge has to be in a Roman court. Therefore, it's got to be political. These false accusation, this accusation is on a whole new level of telling lies and manipulating what has been said. When challenged by Pilate himself, they don't just bend the truth, they snap the truth. They believe that they believe what they want to believe about Jesus, and it is unfounded. The accusations that are there are simply not true. Friends, we live in a culture. We live at a time and in a society that loves to throw mud, doesn't it? You've only got to look at the national newspapers and the tabloids and the media, who just love throwing mud at other people. No more so than the accusations about God. They are multiplied. You will often hear angrily people saying, "Why has God let that happen?" Or, "You Christians believe in a God who says this, but look what's going on. You live, well, and you serve a God of love. How is that love?" Accusations are thrown again and again. How can you believe in a God that does that? And men and women shake their fist at God. They profane his name. They use it only as a curse. Can I advise you? Can I advise you to be very careful what you accuse God of? The consequences are eternal. I came across an anonymous quote the other day, which I found really helpful. It says this: "Before you condemn and accuse someone, make sure you have all the facts, for only a fool opens their mouths and accuses without the entire story." Maybe you're watching this morning and you've been shaking your fist at God. You've been accusing him of all kinds of things. Friend, listen. Only a fool doesn't take into account all that God has said. When it comes to Jesus, we live in a world of fools who refuse to trust him because they refuse to hear his words. They don't know the whole story. They're not willing to accept all that Jesus has said. Don't be fooled. Seek the truth. Seek out for yourself about these things of God. Don't just work on other people's hearsay. Find out for yourself what God has said. Don't accuse, but listen. It's the second question. And this question, well, here is a question that is much more personal and pointed at Jesus. Verse 33 says this: "Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus and asked him, 'Are you a king?'" Here was a man who was well acquainted with kings and rulers and those in authority. But this Jesus, this man in front of him, he doesn't look very regal. He's a carpenter's son. He doesn't appear to have a lot of authority around him at this moment. Pilate is taken aback by Jesus' appearance. I think Pilate genuinely and actually is caught off guard by Jesus himself. He was not all that he expected. He was not the angry, stamping his foot, authoritarian, arrogant individual that many kings and rulers and revolutionaries are. He wasn't that kind of character. We know the Bible says that he was gentle, that he was kind, that he was softly spoken even. And although he had those moments where righteous anger came, he was not your typical king or ruler. And do you know, I think this meeting with Pilate deeply affected this individual. Is he a king? Or have they just got this all wrong? In 1976, the African-American preacher, L.S. Lockridge, preached a sermon in Detroit. That sermon was entitled, "That's My King." Here's a 3-minute excerpt from that message that may well change your life.
The Bible says he's a king of the Jews. He's a king of Israel. He's a king of righteousness. He's a king of the ages. He's a king of heaven. He's a king of glory. He's a king of kings, and he is the Lord of lords. Now that's my king. Do you know him? No means of measure can define his limitless love. Well, he's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's impurely powerful. And he's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. Well, he's the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's a fundamental doctrine of true theology. Do you know him? He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he beautifies the meek. Do you know him? My king is a key of knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a pathway of peace. He's a roadway of righteousness. He's a highway of holiness. He's a gateway of glory. Do you know him? His light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. Well, I wish I could describe him to you, but he's indescribable. He's indescribable. Yeah. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. You can't get him out of your mouth. You can't get him off of your hands. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. That's my king. Yeah, he always has been, and he always will be. I'm talking about he had no predecessor, and he'll have no successor. You can't impeach him, and he's not going to resign. That's my king.
And he is still that king. The question is he your king? Is he the king of your life, king of your circumstances, king of your finances, king of your home, king of your decisions? Have you recognized Jesus as king of life in every part? Pilate's challenged. Jesus' response is this your idea? Or someone else told you? We have to make our own plan. We have to make our own decision to follow the King of Kings. The third and final question. It is a question that all humanity needs to ask right now. Because we all need to know one thing. Verse 38. The final question, Pilate says, what is truth? He's responding in that interrogation, in that time together. Jesus affirms that his nature of his kingdom is spiritual. And he says to Pilate, everyone who is of truth, everyone who is truth, will listen to my voice. Pilate clearly is wrestling with the whole concept of that. And in a statement, maybe cynically, maybe in desperation, he says, what is truth? In fact, a better translation of that little phrase is, who can know the truth? Is there such a thing as truth? Boy, do we live in a world where we're clamoring for truth. We want truth from our medics. We want truth from our government. We want truth from our media. We want truth that is honest and open. It's very common today, isn't it? That some flatly deny that truth even exists. There is no such thing as ultimate truth. But you can deny truth, but you cannot extinguish truth. You may not be aware, but it's said that when England closed its Libyan embassy in London, the then ruler of the country, Colonel Gaddafi, was so incensed, so angry, that he ordered that England be removed from every map in Libya. Removing and replacing that country with a new expanse of the North Sea bordered by Scotland and Wales. It sounds ridiculous. But you can try to suppress the truth. You can try to remove the truth, but you cannot extinguish it. It stands in the prayer that Jesus prayed. That high priestly prayer of John 17, 17. We read this. This is what he says. Your word is truth. So make them holy by the truth. Jesus Christ embodies the truth. This word is the truth of life. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Do you believe that? If you are struggling with the truth of all that's going around, can I encourage you, pick the Bible back up. Read again what is said here. Again and again, the truth will strike your heart. What is truth? It's a question that demands a response. It demands an answer from every single person who hears it. It's not enough. It's not enough just to think that everything that other people tell us is true. It's not enough, young people particularly, to look on the internet and to look at social media and believe that everything you read is the truth. It's not even enough to listen to our leaders and our politicians and believe that everything they tell us is true. There is only one place we will find that. And that truth is in Jesus. Pontius Pilate asked those questions, was given a response, but he chose to do nothing with it. What will you do this morning to the truth that Jesus is King and that he offers you eternal life?
Thank you.
Thank you all for joining us at TCC Online. We hope you have a really good day.
Goodbye.